And right now it's time for that time when we have our special guest. Tonight's special guest is my twin brother, Shade Smith, the songwriter for the music group The Rumour. Shade wrote many wonderful songs, and tonight we talk about The Collection. The Collection is 24 songs that have been selected to represent the life and times of The Rumour. The Collection, out now in all good record stores. We welcome Shade Smith as our special guest on The Beat Goes On.
Shade Smith, welcome to The Beat Goes On, my twin brother.
It's good to be here.
Now, Shade, you're in the studio today, and we don't often talk about The Rumour, but The Rumour was a group from the 60s and the 70s, and you were the brains behind The Rumour. You wrote some beautiful songs, and I was the singer, and something wonderful happened in the last couple of weeks. We have released The Collection, 20 of the songs.
That's 20 of the, I don't know how many we recorded, but it's about four or five from the first album, which is Gardenia Smiles, and about five from, or six from Land of New Vigor and Zeal, which is the second album, and then some other singles. So it's got all the important landmarks in our recording career. It's basically a summary, and it also includes two tracks from our school days, or the end of our school days, with the Surfires.
If you are in doubt, there's a wonderful little booklet here which explains all the history of The Rumour. There was one little point here which I think that we should talk about, Shade, before we do anything, because rather sad occasion for the Stebbing family, and yet here it is in the notes. It said, at the end of the high school days, they changed their name to the Surfires and recorded three singles for Eldred Stebbing at Zodiac Records. Only last Friday, 3 days ago,
he passed away.
He passed away and was buried in Auckland. Both you and I would like to pay a great tribute to Eldred Stebbing, who really pioneered recording in Auckland.
Absolutely, and he got our career going. He had the studio under
the house, yes.
In Saratoga Avenue in Herne Bay, and totally committed to it, and we came up and he just made it happen for us, and it was our first journey into recording. Mm. and as well as a lot of bands in Auckland and around New Zealand.
Shade, I'm sure that out there will be somebody saying, who was The Rumour? Who were they? What about giving us a little bit of a history of the group so that...
Who were they?
Yeah, who were they?
Well,
there
was
Where
you.
Did it all start?
Well, there was you.
There was me, anyway.
And there was me. And there was Jacques, and there was Ross. Jacques Coulin and Ross Hyman. And
we were four boys, young boys.
And basically we lived...
In the town of Huntly.
The town of Huntly in the early 60s.
Yes. Now, nothing would have happened, really. We would have just done that, except for your songwriting ability. During all this, you had plugged away at writing songs, and one day you came to see me and you said, I've written a great song, and you showed it to me. And it was our biggest hit song, called L'amour est l'enfant de la liberté, called Love is the Child of Freedom, which everywhere I go in New Zealand, same with you, somebody says, yeah, I've got a copy of that. I think in the end it sold 120,000 copies, didn't it?
Something like that, yeah.
What was it about, you know, with your guitar, you were sitting down there one day, you'd read that statement, hadn't you? L'amour est l'enfant de la liberté.
I read it in a book. It was in a book. It was just a French saying called Love is the Child of Freedom.
But, yeah. You came up with that riff. So you came up with an idea. So.
Once was a time when I felt in my mind that I'd never give way to you. 'Cause all that I wanted was to have you cornered. But you said our love would be blue. L'amour est l'enfant de la liberté. You try, please, to understand. L'amour est l'enfant de la liberté. Love
words are still relevant today, aren't they?
Yes, I think. Well, it's a timeless or universal theme that love cannot be exist out if it's in a controlled situation. So it has to be a choice. And I think that also it did coincide with a sort of a freeing up of the ideas of love. It was the hippie generation, and as you can see from our hair and our paisley shirts and flares, it was the hippie times, and there was a lot of songs in that vein at that time. So it just struck a chord. We were very surprised with the success of it. We thought it was going to be. We were trying our best all the time. So it was our fourth single, and we had been. We had working as hard as we could in the studio and trying to promote and going around radio stations and doing press and really trying, and nothing was ever happening. Yeah. And then we got into Studio One, and the moment it appeared on that TV show, it just sort of exploded, and all of a sudden it just spread like wildfire. And we didn't have to do any sort of promotion or pushing. Everyone just took off, you know.
So it was thanks to Studio One, and I think you and I should really say, Chris Bourne, if you're watching, thank you for organizing and producing Studio One, because it gave the rumor a wonderful opportunity. In fact, if it hadn't been for Studio One, probably that song wouldn't be as well known as it is today.
Absolutely. He helped a lot of, he gave so many artists a great start in their careers, and it was he did a great job.
Now, as a writer, Shade, I mean, wow, great success in that first year. So you started writing again. Next year, Studio One again, of course, and you were busy writing, and another two great hits, wasn't there? Holy Morning and Suzanne sang a beautiful song called Sunshine Through a Prism.
Yep.
So tell us a little about those two songs.
Holy Morning was a wedding song, and that was, it's a long time ago. It's strange to be asked, get yourself back to where, what you're doing when you wrote it, or what you were thinking.
Let's just have a quick listen to Holy Morning, just to refresh your memory.
Holy morning, bless our ears with streams of sunshine falling.
It was a wonderful hit song for the rumour, but it wasn't all plain sailing.
It became controversial in the judging, because in Studio One, what happened was somehow people felt cheated by the change of the rules, because it's sort of like the previous year the rules, as I remember it, was that
once you had your score, it stayed there.
You got your number, and then it went forward. Well, what happened was Holy Morning came along, and we got 72. I remember 72, and it was leading with 72. So it was going to win. And then they rejudged it, and they put all the other songs higher, and I think it even went lower, I'm not sure.
But it ended up as number four.
It was number four. So people felt as if they hadn't been told about the change. It was